that South African Wi-Fi like? Pleasure.
Thabo, Rametsi. What up, King? What up, Ken? Oh, it's been
blessing.
A long time.
You want to go like that? Blessing, brother. Blessing.
Yeah, I retain, man. I retain. How you doing, man? Like, it's so crazy. I feel like we know each other because we've spoken so much.
Yeah.
Yeah, man. You're just like a kindred brother. You're kind of doing. I'm so amped, man. For like Nature Boy, for everything that you're like cooking in the streets, bro. Like, I'm so freaking out, man.
God bless, man. Thank you so much, man, for the support. And I loved your work when I first saw it, and I was like, I got to get, when I go to South Africa, at the point I go, I'm hitting you, man, because there's so many
things. You got to come through.
When I saw Kalushi, and when I saw that performance, man, it was like, damn, it was fire. You know, South African movies in general, always of Serafina, To Catch a Fire. I knew these are American-based movies about South Africa.
But,
anything having to do with that, you know, considering myself a Pan-African, I've always thought amazing things, and your performance was unbelievable in that in Amanla. And I want to say, if anyone out there who watches this has Netflix, watch Amanla. You will see this man perform his heart out, and it's like a great performance, man. A great performance.
Wow. You know? Thanks, Ken. Yo, man, you gassing me up. Thank you, bro.
I'm not gassing. I'm only telling you.
I'm excited because I feel like I went through a stage of, I took like a year off and I went to different African countries to work with different African directors. I went to Botswana, I went to Zimbabwe, I went to like, you know, different places. And because my dream was always to make like a film in each African country and then possibly a film in the world. Like, and what's so interesting is that the infrastructure is, you know, varies from country to country.
Yeah.
But the essence of storytelling is such an innately African thing. It's like so entrenched in all of us that even if the camera is maybe not the best or like, you know, maybe there's like a boom coming in and all that.
You get it.
People are still captivated by the story. You look at Nollywood, with all due respect, hasn't had the highest quality compared to like maybe, I don't know, Western standards in terms of the filmmaking. But the story has always been so powerful. So I'm just glad to be an African storyteller and speaking to another African storyteller.
Amen, man. Amen. I couldn't have said it any better than that. And truthfully, we're in a, because of COVID, because of the way the world is so interconnected now, and literally I hop on my, in this country, in the States right now, I don't even know if I'm pronouncing it right. Amapiano. How do you say that?
No, that was pretty good. I'm not even going to say, that was perfect. I'm not going to pronounce this. Amapiano. Amapiano.
It's new for me. It's new because like, I hear this music, I'm listening to it, and it's everywhere here. You go out in nightclubs, you go out in lounges. I see people, they call it Afrobeat, but it's Amapiano.
It's not. It's different. It's different.
Yeah, but like most people will just be like Afrobeat here, but at least they have it. You know what I mean? It's like,
Afrobeat. I'm glad. Look, I think African culture has always sort of crossed over. It's just, I think now it's receiving recognition for being exactly that, which is African culture. Afrobeat or even Afrobeats, which is two different genres. Which is another thing people need to understand. Like, those are two very different things, Afrobeat and Afrobeats.
Yeah.
Then there's Amapiano, but we also took our Gom, which traveled so well before that. So I think the pulse is on Africa right now. And I'm glad, because when I was in LA, man, with my partner, we said that I remember walking down the street and seeing Zulu hats and Zulu regalia and just seeing, I was like, how did we get here? And then I remember we've always been here.
Yeah,
you know, whether it was the Miriam Makebas, the Huma Sikelas, you know, the Abdullah Ibrahim, you know, I mean, Tefe Semenya, Leta Mbuli, who did a song with Michael Jackson, Nigerian girl, she does opening vocals, you know, and it transcends to Salif Keita, you know, I mean, we have so many fantastic musicians, and our music has always landed there, but now it's like the recognition.
The culture hasn't been taken without
the end.
And it's like, it's more so, you know, I personally think, obviously, it started with, like, a movement of Black Panther. When the film was coming out, that was a huge push. But not only that film, I think, like, just the fact that there's a wave of these immigrants like myself who have, like, come into positions of power. I'm not in any position of power, but I mean, they've come into positions of power. come into a place where it's like now acceptable. When I was young in this country, and you say you're from Cameroon, they're just like,
What?
Like, what are you talking about? But now, at least because we have UFC fighters, we have African Nations Cup, all of this stuff is happening where it's like, man, you can have some representation in the arts and show who you are, you know, versus just being, are you from Nigeria, you know?
Well, okay, firstly, shout out to Francis Ngannou. I backed him all the way, so shout out to Cameroon. I always wanted to go to Cameroon. I'm obsessed with Cameroon, actually.
Man, let me know. Let me know. Please, you don't go to the country when I'm not in the country. I should be in the country now. Don't let me know.
No. We'll connect. But yeah, man. I feel like wherever Africans go, they dominate. I mean, it's easy. People forget that. The biggest degrees now are switching from like the Asian community to being the most educated people in America now, usually African immigrants. I think they're going to the highest sort of degrees. Nigerians make up most of the black doctors in America. There's always been a system.
Specifically. Because like as a filmmaker, I've gone into a lot of interesting spaces. Like I do art and then I do technology. So I have my own company, which is called PromoteYourFirm.com. That's literally the name of it. And I do media marketing. And I remember when the Black Lives Matter movement was happening here in New York and the riots were happening, I took my camera out. I made a video. I filmed it. And then I put it online. Then I get contacted by this politician in Tennessee who's like, listen, you're very passionate about what you do. Can you be passionate for me? And I'm like, how much are we talking about?
Right.
I'm very passionate. It was a moment. So I got into the realm of like politics and seeing people in politics. And there's a lot of African people behind the scenes in terms of like working in campaigns and working in smaller local government, you know. And it's just a good time to see this level of representation. And only more will come. Only more will come. You know, we just got to keep grinding.
Our only propaganda should be African excellence. That's it. That's the only propaganda, African excellence. That's it. All this other narrative, we don't need to perpetuate them. Just African excellence. And not to be excellence for white people or for any other people.
Yeah.
Purely for honoring our legacy. Absolutely. Beyond honoring our own legacies. It's just like perpetuating the greatness that we've always carried in our DNA and our knowledge. I mean, we can go back to Africa. Like we are the nexus of life. You know, Africa is the Garden of Eden. You know, this is where it all begins. And we were the first prototypes, but we also were like the prototype was mastered. So every version of humanity existed and pre-existed right here in this continent. So we need to perpetuate human excellence beyond African excellence.
Positivity, man. We have to perpetuate positivity. And what I try to do with my company, in terms of art, it's called Sun People Productions, and I focus on underrepresented people, but it's not strictly a Black American or a Black African perspective. Yes. My perspective is underrepresented people, irregardless race or culture. If there's a story about someone in Azerbaijan living in a tribal life, I want to tell that story. Someone in the hills of Patagonia or something like that in Argentina. I'm all about like telling like these stories because there's so much diversity, especially here in New York, that you never really know about. And you know, it's just sad that we only have these same narratives where it's like, okay, you have the gangster film or you have this basic love story or you have this horror movie with the same thing. There's so many things. What about, you know, films about existential crisis and realizing who we are as people? There's so much more to depth in life than what we're thrown out, you know. But anyway, more stories to come. Yeah. More stories to come.
More stories.
Indeed. So, man, in terms of like Kalushi, when you were filming, I gotta ask you, like, what research did you do to prepare for the role?
Word. You know, I was very fortunate for that role. It was my first lead character, and just to prelude all of this, like, generally what was happening, and I know Samuel L. Jackson will say the opposite, but there was no. We weren't allowed as South Africans to play our own heroes. So Steve Biko was played by Denzel Washington, Nelson Mandela was played by Morgan Freeman, by the late and great Sidney Poitier. So there was rarely a chance where a political icon was actually played by a South African. In South Africa, with South African taxpaying money paying for those movies.
Wow.
You know what I mean? They wouldn't let us read. Imagine telling Americans, and I understand that Americans generally lose their big characters to British actors. I get that, but that's been happening to us from them way. So I don't even feel their complaints. So when I went on to Kalushi, I was like the first to be in a lead role to play a South African, like, you know, political activist. I was the first person to do that, and that I don't say that with pride. You know, I don't say that with pride. That's sad. That's sad. You know, because when you can't tell your own story, who are you? You know, when someone else is telling your story for you, when you don't see yourself as a hero and you see other people being the heroes you were actually born into, it takes away. It takes away so much, man. That's why representation has become such a key point in filmmaking and art, is because we understand the huge psychological effect of being represented. So that was the first thing. But yeah, just to answer your question, prepping for it, I had a great director in Manja Dube, who directed the film. And he trained in America. He was on the Italian Job. He was the African Film Institute, AFI.
Okay.
Yeah, he's part of the AFI. He was like 21 and he won like best cinematographer at like the AFI. He was like the first African. He was crazy. Like, so my dad's like, he's like next level. So he treated the film process, and I hate to say it like this, in the same way that Hollywood treats the process, where you give an actor enough time to prepare. And I'll tell you what generally happens here, right? So he cast me before he got a producer, before he had crew, before everything. He cast the actors first.
Wow, okay.
Yeah. That's important.
That's a passion project on this side. I understand that completely, yeah.
Well, to be truthful, he actually had already raised the cash. He had already raised the cash, but he understood, because he also trained under, I think it was F. Gary Gray and Antoine Fuqua. He learned from Antoine Fuqua. And then a great cinematographer. Who's Antoine Fuqua? I think he's Filipino. He's a fantastic cinematographer.
Yeah, I know what you're talking about.
Oh, how can I forget his name? I forget. Sorry, but yeah, but he's like, so he's trained under those guys, and I remember when he picked us, he said to me, I'm going to make sure you're prepared for this. I'm going to treat you like a Hollywood actor. And you have to behave that way. And so I'm going to give you months of rehearsal. And we're going to travel. And we literally did this. We went through Solomon Mahlangu, the character I played, to where he was born, to where he moved to, where he was initiated. And this is across the country. He wasn't just in one place. I literally walked his entire life. Before I even shot a single frame, before there was a producer or anything.
Man, that's
met his family, met his brother. Funny thing is, his uncle said that I looked nothing like him. And my co-star, Thabo Malema, who's just a sensational actor, he said, this guy should play him, not this guy. He's like, how are you going to play him? You don't even look like him. So I was like, I'll take care of it. Don't worry. But
oh my God.
Yeah, so I had a great deal of preparation. So I was really on with a great director, a great auteur.
Man, I have to say that it was a very powerful film, specifically because, you know, I'm a huge fan of African history, and specifically anything having to do with like the border wars or South Africa. You know, I was born in Central African Republic, and that itself is just like we're pretty much the center of everything which is happening in Central Africa. So there were a lot of people from South Africa there. There was a lot of people from Angola. And I heard stories as a kid about the situation in terms of like the conflict, the border war. There were diplomats who were coming and going, and so just seeing that, and seeing the representation of the conflict in terms of like the armed struggle which was going on, you know, people didn't realize that there were, you know, this conflict was going on for like over 20 years in terms of like Rhodesia, South Africa. Yeah. Mozambique, all of these conflicts which were brewing, and then to have a freedom fighter like that, and you play him, is just unbelievable, man. You captured the character. I don't know the guy, obviously. I didn't grow up to
learn him
in school, but you know, just seeing, you know, the human spirit and the human struggle like portrayed that way was very powerful, man. And I have to say,
thank you so
you're
much.
A hell of an actor. You're a hell of an actor, man.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you, bro. I just want to add on what you're saying is that the film took me around the continent, and I got to be with politicians, politicians who can be perceived as good or bad. We showcased the movie for different people. I had the privilege of showcasing for the late Robert Mugabe and a whole bunch of other representatives. So it was ambassadors from Cameroon, everywhere, man. And I remember we were sitting seated down after the movie. And it was, they booked out a whole theater, and it was just Mugabe's sort of representation and all the big sort of ambassadors. And after that, we had dinner in Zimbabwe, in Harare. And I remember all these African leaders saying, "What? Like, they're so envious of South Africa being able to tell stories of their own heroes." And then I was like, "Why don't you guys do it?" He's like, "You know, we always think of the arts as nothing, and we throw it away. We always think there's more important things to fight for." Then I remember I said to them, "Well, I'm not." You know, and I think in that moment when they watched Kalushi, they realized the power of art. Art is the purest form of propaganda. And if you want to propagate people to be great, you use art. Absolutely. You look at the American story, the cowboys and Indians. That was the first form of film propaganda I can think of right now. After that, obviously, is Hitler. And he's beautifully shot, but obviously cruel sort of movies with Hitler. But the cowboy and Indian is the first example of propaganda. They made the cowboy look like the hero. Meanwhile, he's the invader coming in to kill, rape, pillage from the native person who's just defending their land. Yeah. But the way that they shot the movies, the John Wayne of everything, twisted our minds to make us think like, hey, no, that the murderer, the killer, the rapist, he's the hero here.
Yeah.
And the people defending themselves are the enemy. And we don't do that. We don't propagate greatness in Africans and show them heroes and excellence. We don't show them the Zambians try to go to space and had a space station and put the, you know, we don't show that we had like a nuclear plant 3 million years ago on this continent. You know, we don't show those elements about ourselves. There's so much to propagate that we're not propagating at all. So I think that's if I'm proud of anything with that movie, regardless of whatever things I might not agree with it, I'm proud that when it reached other leaders, they saw the need to tell their story. That was probably the best thing for me.
And that's a victory, man. That's a victory in any sense of the word. And, you know, I commend you for that. I shot a film in Cameroon called Scam Republic. And this was like my film school in terms of like making films in Africa. Because everything that you could think of that goes wrong went wrong when we were filming. Everything in terms of like, I had a cast of crew from the States, Brazil, just a bunch of filmmakers which came together to work on this project. And literally, it's like, we don't have this location. Oh, by the way, the power is going to die. The power is going to die. A light bulb is going to explode in the face of the director. It's like, at the time, I wasn't even a director. I was just a writer trying to like learn how to do film. And it was trial by fire. And I understand that. Yeah. And I think now, you know, I specifically had gone with the South American cinematographer because of their quality of filmmaking compared to the Nollywood African style, where it's like, I don't want to say it's not good, but in terms of like a level of quality, which I wanted to aspire to in terms of that. I feel that with the advent of technology, what's happening now in all of this being so connected, there's always this new video, new dance thing on new craze on Instagram or TikTok, that now the level of technology and quality of work is there. We just have to actually put our heads together and tell these like worthwhile stories that need to be told, because there's so many things that can be done. Even I'm not even saying like historical epics, but I mean like things in our day, these countries have gone to war. They've gone through so many things that no one knows about. It's just, you know, bald kid with flies and skinny, and that's all they know.
Yeah, the usual crap,
or scammer, or internet scammer. That's really it. So it's really important for us to go out there and do what we're doing and keep on fighting that fight, man. And, you know, it's good to meet a brother in arms, too. You know?
Oh, yeah, man. That's all we got to do. You know what's crazy? It's like we always put such emphasis on like winning an Academy Award and stuff. And I get that. That comes with prestige. But it also comes with a financial incentive. Like here in South Africa, if you win our equivalent, the SAFTA, it doesn't change your career in the slightest. Nothing changes. You just won an award and that's it. Yeah. Bro, like it's crazy. Like you can win awards till Kingdom Come here. Your pay raise doesn't go up. None of that goes up. And I think So the reason we generally aspire, it's like the NCAAP or NAACP awards, awards. Oh, sorry, I'm dyslexic. All of those things. The only reason we don't attach prestige is because there's no like immediate return on getting that, and we need to place importance on things like that. You know. So things like quality. It's so interesting. You talk about like us always having to fetch like people from outside, you know, from other spaces to come tell us, to help us tell stories. We have great cinematographers across the country, the continent.
Amazing.
They don't have access to an Ari. They don't have access to a Sony Venice. They don't have access
don't
to
say that out loud.
Great Sigma lensing. I'm sorry. You know what I mean? Like, imagine they did though. Imagine they did.
Yeah.
You know, imagine they had the best glass. Imagine they could afford to light up an entire freaking set the way they want to and not just depend on natural light. Fair play, you have someone like Emmanuel Lubezki, for example, who's my favorite cinematographer. He prides himself on using natural light. But he can afford to book out the whole day just to shoot one scene at night. TIA, we don't have that luxury, man.
No. At this point, not yet, but it's coming. And when we would have that luxury, you know, but it also brings with it a sense of resilience and a sense of you have to be creative with what you have now, especially now that people, well, I shoot with a Panasonic GH5. But my lens is in turn, I use a Sennheiser lens, not to be too specific, but it's a very good, I have great glass. I have great glass for the camera.
And which is what you need.
You know, glass. So the glass is very important, but at the same time, you have to be able to convey emotion, and you can't just, you know, point and expect you get greatness. There still has to be a level of creativity with what you're doing in order to be able to achieve that. And I think that working without that next level glass and working without those props, if you can get as close to that or tell a powerful story and people see that in what you worked with, then it's like, oh my God, did you see what he did? Did you see what they did without this?
Word.
This is the one. This is who we go with. You know, that's why it's like very important. And it's like, yeah, you know, yeah, okay. I have a knife in a gunfight, but I'm still going to win. You know?
Yeah. Facts. You know, another thing that Africans have, and I'll speak very proudly as a South African filmmaker in this regard. We have way less resources, but I think through the streamers you're going to see, we're competing on any level in terms of quality. The big difference with South Africans is that we can shoot, 20 scenes a day sometimes, 27 scenes a day.
Are you serious?
Yeah, that's like
That's crazy. Yeah, I thought I was gangster. Because here, okay, typically, with real huge American budgets, they'll do two scenes, maybe three at most.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah,
I thought I was gangster because I'm like, yeah, I could do seven in a day. But to do 20, Jesus Christ.
27. You can shoot a whole season of a show in 2 weeks.
With that level of quality, it's unbelievable.
Shoot an ep a day. But it's because no budget. So, and the difference is, which is also sucks, is that we don't have unions, right? Which is horrible. But it means that generally one person, everybody on set can do like six different jobs.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, like everybody can do like, and everyone chips in. So if I move a prop and I help you out, I'm not like infringing on your union rights or whatever. Oh, I mean, like,
I gotta work in South Africa.
We're just telling the story.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're just telling the story. It's very guerrilla, it's very aggressive, but we also are the hardest people on ourselves. Even with the Ama Piano and our music. Nobody, like, our black Twitter is the biggest bully on the internet streets, period. Just research South African black Twitter. We ain't scared of nobody. The only reason we're not scared of nobody because we're so hard on ourselves.
Yeah.
We're always expecting excellence. Always. We're so, so hard. Sometimes too hard, to be honest with you, as South Africans. And we know our circumstances. We know the lack of resources, but we're always demanding greatness from ourselves. Even when we're messing up, man. Even when we're messing up, to be real with you. Yeah.
I just can't believe I'm still shocked by 20 scenes a day. It took my heart away.
CIA, baby. CIA.
First off, because the films which I see coming out of South Africa, in terms of cinematography, in terms of directing, in terms of like actor blocking, they're so good, and it's like I have to know, you know, this may be a trade secret or what, but do you like rehearse it like a play before you actually go about filming? Because it seems like it's too good. Like, you guys didn't just get together and plan like 3 weeks and, hey, say we're going to shoot this. This was like, let's treat it like a theater production and then have cameras attached as well.
I wish. Let me say this. And when I told you about the Kalushi journey, it was read that I was given a chance to research. Bro, generally you cost like maybe 3 days before you have to shoot.
Are you fucking serious? This is crazy, man.
Yeah. Like, that's why it was so different with Mindlight, and that's why I like working with him. He costs first and then gets into the movie. Yeah. But 9 times out of 10, most cases, you'll read first and then you'll get the part and they say, okay, you start tomorrow. Here your sides, let's go. And then you have to make it work. You don't have a choice. So it's very rare that we have rehearsal time. We can't afford it. You just need to know your shit, bro. Like, it's that simple. It's actually, if you can't survive, someone's going to swallow you in the scene. You know, we don't have time. We're shooting 27 scenes a day. We don't, and without rehearsal, we don't have time. Okay, look, I mean, on average, 27 is a lot. We do shoot 27 and 26. On average, it's easy to do a 13, 16 scene a day. That's like, you have a good budget.
That's something from Bollywood. I've never seen that kind of thing done before.
Similar work ethic. But I think we're just competitive. That thing I was telling you, not competitive with each other even. We just always trying to do well. And South African artists don't get paid very well. So, like, we're not doing this for the money.
Yeah.
We're doing this to be dope. Like, really to be dope. And to add on this, a lot of film is shot in South Africa. So you won't even believe a lot of American stuff that you think is shot in America is actually shot right here in South Africa. The whole thing. Like, I've got a catalog of just, I've worked with Meryl Streep. I've worked with Daniel Radcliffe. I've worked with, you name them, I've worked with them. Like, and they've all come here.
Wow.
For films that you think were shot elsewhere, they were shot here. So whenever they put us in the scene, and to be honest with you, it's usually glorified extras, but none of our actors are ever shook. I can't say there's ever been a great American actor that's come and shook. I can bring any actor and say, nah, go ahead. Oh, that's Denzel. I respect Denzel, but I think Lemu Hung's got it. I think Pattinson has got it. I think Wogang's got it. Like, we wouldn't be shook. Like, Meryl Streep doesn't shake us. You know, Jeffrey Wright, nobody shakes us. Like, nobody.
Love that confidence, nobody. Man. I love that confidence, you know. Love that confidence. Have, like, that level of talent in terms of, like, actors who are that dedicated to the craft. That brings me to, okay, I got to explain this because I'm sure that people who are going to watch this aren't really sure about, like, when we're talking about scenes. Right, I said I could do 7 and you're doing 20 to 26. What that entails is, if you're going to film a scene, you have to block it out with the actors. You have to make sure the lights are in the proper positions for the shot. And then after you finish that, you have to move it in case you might have to move the lights, might have to change the position of the actors. Exactly. And this is still just one scene that we're working on here. Yeah. Okay. It really, and this is like, this whole process in itself, you know, people go to the bathroom, people need to do this, people need to do that. You have to mark your place to make sure that you're in the same location where as the cameras move. So people need to understand. I'm thinking I'm good when I'm saying 7. You're over here telling me 20 to 26 in a day. I can only imagine. Like, in terms of memorization, how much of it then comes down to, like, we have the general concept of this, but we can also play and ad lib and use the characters and use the words and put them in our own words. Is that something that comes with that? Because it just seems like that's so much to actually memorize.
Most definitely, we definitely have that. Like, we have good memories, but I do think we have such a strong theater culture, which I do think America, which is ironic, right, kind of lacks in a theater culture, not in terms of Broadway, but like in terms of really, really appreciating the theater actor. You know, a lot of Black American actors when I was there were complaining that it didn't work, right?
No, you cut out. You cut out for a second.
Oh, sorry. Hold on. Okay, let me get off this.
You're saying Black American actors, and you took off for a second. Okay. As soon as he was getting in on Black American actors, the microphone cut off. Conspiracy. I don't know. Possibly. But
Oh, there we go.
You're on opposite side now. Yeah, I can hear you now. So you were saying a lot of Black American actors.
they sleep on, and I'm not saying Black American actors don't go to theater at all. That's not true. But I think what the British actors usually have up on them is have a strong theater culture. And they're trained very hard, like, especially the Black, the sort of the, because especially the immigrant kids, firstly, already, like, in England. Yeah. So they, yeah. You know what I mean? So already there's such a pressure at home, the fact that they're not being doctors and all that stuff to be excellent to begin with.
Oh my God, this is my entire life, man. This is my... You're not a doctor, you're not a lawyer, you're not a go. You're my dude.
Let's you're dead, basically.
You're dead, you're dead. It's only now that people are like, oh, you can come to the... It's only now that my community is kind of like, bro, I hear you, man. I hear you. I know exactly what you're saying when you deal with arts. But yeah,
so that pressure like kills. The Black actor in America is lucky if they make it through Broadway system. I mean, that's so hard. Like, that's freaking that's crazy. Right?
Yeah.
It's hard. So there's not much theater for them to really practice and go at it. And I'm sorry, that's why you will lose to a Daniel Aloyo to Martin Luther King. He's just had these muscles trained a bit more than the opportunities you were provided. And that's the sad narrative there. And I really wish Black Americans were given a better pathway and a good development structure as you would use it in soccer to get into those roles. Because otherwise you just get a guy who's maybe if he's lucky, he's gone to a great university. And still, man, you can go to a great university. That's not really being like on stage.
Yeah.
That's not really being on a set. That's not really like, you know.
So being able to play against someone completely. Yeah, yeah.
So I think that's a disadvantage American actors generally have is that there's no honor in being from the theater. You know, it's kind of looked down upon because you can get a quicker check and you can get, like cash all the time for being in TV. But we're forced to sort of like struggle through the theater system. We're forced to that. So I think that's a big, and I guess once you can handle a play, somebody hands you a script and you have like two takes, you'll be fine. You'll be fine. I think it's amazing, man.
You make me want to go film something in South Africa this year. That's how amazing how that sounds because, it just seems like it's the big leagues in terms of being able to do so much with so little and still create such magnificent work. For me, I have like my different schools of cinema, which I love in terms of like the top tier for me in terms of like world cinema, French cinema is on another level in terms of like cinematography, in terms of like lighting, in terms of blocking, in terms of their concepts and stories. And then after that, I would say it's a tie between Italian and Brazilian filmmaking. Because, but when I see South African, I see something there where it's like they're making these powerful films. They don't necessarily have the resources of Italian or the Brazilian government funding projects, but it's still such a level of like skill that, man, they get some investors behind them and they're just going to be dangerous. You know, I'd really like to start telling stories like my dream project moving forward would be do something dealing primarily with Afrofuturism. Like, I think that's a whole concept that we haven't really explored. Black Panther kind of played with it a bit, but there's so many things we can draw up from history and put together, which is just like, what the hell did I just watch? You know, like something like that's really powerful. Play with like light colors and palettes and, you know, throw Saturn in the moon and just,
Well, I'm actually busy with something like that right now. I can't get into too depth with it, but I'm pitching it to on very soon. On the 11th of February, I have a very big pitch regarding a project very similar to that I've designed. It's kind of like an African Blade Runner, in a sense.
Wow, man.
Yeah. It's called Nomalizo. It's based on a song by Leta Mbuli.
Nomalizo.
It's called Nomalizo. It's looking promising. So we'll touch base. But that's exactly what I'm into. I'm into sci-fi. That's my journey. I've done a lot of dramas. The reason we're so good at dramas is because they're the cheapest thing to make.
You know,
but I think every African craves action. We grew up on Jean-Claude Van Damme.
Yeah.
We grew up on Arnold Schwarzenegger.
Yeah.
You know, Cynthia Rothrock. Like we
Bruce grew up Lee.
Action. Bruce, all Chinese cinema, Hong Kong cinema. We grew up on all of that, you know, so that was really huge. So that's what we're looking for. There's a guy called, that's my homie, Mr. Nabi there, he's action. He's such a big action star here, like one of the guys commenting. And we're just trying to create. Hold on, man. Yeah, you should check out his profile. He's incredible. He's a stunt guy. He's just a fantastic actor.
What's his name again for people?
Yeah, on Instagram, this is Mr. Nabi. There. Okay. Check him out there. Mr. Nabi.
Okay, I'll definitely check out his work.
Nah, just check him out. But yeah, man, I think we also want to step out and do Afrofuturism and superhero stuff and play around, man. I'm really keen for that.
No, for sure. It's going to be, you know, as technology becomes more accessible and these things become bigger in terms of having community, you just need a community and dedicated people around you, and you can tell some amazing stories. What I'm seeing, you know, even just because I film in New York City on a regular basis, like, I'm seeing productions from all around the world happening here, like small productions, which people are doing. Sometimes on my street, I'll see, like, one time I saw, was it South Korea? They were filming, like, this South Korean, like, show here on the street. And I'm just like, okay, maybe I can walk in the background and just be, like, an extra in that. But I've seen Australian as well. It's like these little productions which are being done for the globals, like, they want New York. They want that feel. So, you know, as technology becomes more accessible and then, you know, unfortunately, the movie industry in terms of like the big theaters are kind of it's in the decline.
Yeah,
we're gonna catch up and pass that gap, or at least like bridge that gap very soon. In terms of like, look, we might not have that Alexa all holy red, but damn, it looks damn we're close. So that's where we're gonna be, and I don't think it's gonna be even longer than 10 years before we're there to that point. To be honest,
nah, you know? Facts, man. My pinnacle for filmmaking right now, well, as the South Koreans for me are for me, they're for me at the pinnacle of storytelling, because they've found a balance between making great artistic work that has great commercial appeal. That's rare.
Like, yeah.
Rare. So as much as like I appreciate the French cinema and I appreciate Italian cinema, I think sometimes it can get a little bit laborious and sort of indulgent and sort of like the artsy fartsiness of it all. Whereas the Koreans, they don't mind putting a pretty boy, but the pretty boy can act.
Yeah.
It really goes in. The cinematography is incredible. The story, they've always got and they've got the key aspects that I really appreciate. Make them laugh, make them cry, you know, make them wait. Those kind of elements. And they put in all their cinema in their TV show. So those are my favorite. I actually want to go to South Korea and make movies there for 2 years. I'd love to
show that. Is amazing. That would actually, I support this decision. That is amazing. Primarily because, I feel that, you know, American cinema has gotten, I don't want to say cookie cutter, but when you follow like the script writing method, it's like the hero goes up, there's an incident, it goes down, movie's over. But when it comes to like, at least Korean cinema, there isn't just a clear cut hero arc. There's like so many different things. There's so much intricate detail to their stories that, they have funding. And it's just amazing to see, like, some of the projects which have come out. You know, here in the States, the Squid Games has become, like, the huge thing. You know, it's big there, too.
It's big everywhere. It was, like, the biggest show in the world. Yeah,
I saw that. I was like, what? And, like, I used to watch a lot of, like, Japanese cinema back in the Akira Kurosawa. Can't name it
Kurosawa,
anything he's done, I've seen, and it's just like amazing projects, man. But Korean cinema right now, they're killing it. The first thing I saw was the Snowpiercer.
Oh yeah, Bong Joon-ho. He's first. Yeah. That was like when he's first forayed to Hollywood.
Yeah,
I think that had Evans in it, if I remember correctly. Yeah, it did. That had a great cast. I love that Snowpiercer. I didn't like the, with all due respect, the remake. The Netflix remake on TV, on the series.
There's a series? I didn't like.
There's a series on Netflix. Yeah. I didn't like it because I think the movie had such, you felt, I love it when you feel the risk. I love it when like the stakes are high.
Mm-hmm.
And really, I felt like with Bong Joon-ho's one, I think I felt like the stakes were at their ultimate high. And I think that was Chris Evans' best performance.
It was a beautiful film. There was that one moment in there where, you know, he's pondering. I don't want to ruin it for anyone who's not seen the film, but I got to tell this part. There's this point in the movie where he's contemplating a great decision, and he opens up that trap door. And what he sees in that trap door, my heart sank. And I'm just like, I can't believe this is beautiful. This is horrible. This is everything I love. This is, yeah, that was filmmaking.
Korean cinema.
Yeah, Korean cinema.
Has a flawed hero.
Yeah.
Always has a flawed hero. I love that. There's a show that I really like from Korea called Extracurricular.
Okay.
It's Extracurricular. It's not on Netflix. It's Korean. South Korean. It's, you know, it's like a teenage, it's so weird because I don't like this kind of stuff usually.
Mm-hmm.
But it's like a teenage high school show about this kid who ends up running a brothel.
Okay.
And he uses his own classmates and he's like a pimp.
So it's a Korean pimp TV show on Netflix and I'm just hearing about it now. Got you. Yeah, checking that out.
And he's a high school kid and it's got so much depth in it. If I were to pitch it to you, you'd be like, nah, I don't want that.
Yeah. Watch it. Korean pimps.
Yeah, man.
Korean high school pimps. Okay, like I'm Dong Hee Kim as one of the main cast. I'm definitely gonna check this out.
Check that extracurriculars. I think it's good. I'm enjoying All of Us Are Dead, which is like a zombie movie.
I've started like the first episode of that. I haven't got too deep into it.
I'm still getting into it.
Yeah.
I like enjoying it so far, so we'll see. I'll say
Silverton Siege.
Yeah, Silverton Siege. Coming out on Netflix. Probably April. Okay.
So check out Silverton Siege. Thabo, Rametsi, and Silverton Siege. Coming out on Netflix.
Sir. Yes, sir. That's what I can talk about for now.
Listen.
There's a project I'm doing there in LA. And but I can't release. Well, not LA, Vancouver, actually. But I can't really talk about any of the other stuff. But yeah.
See, February 11th, I'm actually curating a show for Fashion Week here in New York. It's going to be at the Expo on Broadway downtown in Manhattan. Aside from that, I have my film Nature Boy, which was a passion project of mine about sort of like an existential journey. It's an African kid who goes joyriding with two Black American kids on the south side of Chicago. And it's just, you know, based a lot on my experiences of my friends and, you know, the city of Chicago and how I saw it and how we saw it compared to, you know, other groups. And it's just that. And I hope that people enjoy it. It's not heavily focused on it's more focused on the city as a whole, at least from a perspective of someone who grew up on the outskirts of Chicago, because I'm from the suburbs, you know, but I grew up in Chicago. So it was like a weird dynamic, you know, moving in between, you know, Black American culture and then the African house, which I lived in, you know, and just like that whole dynamic. It's called Nature Boy, and that's what I'm working on right now. And yeah, man, it's been a pleasure. Thabo, hopefully I'll speak to you soon.
Thank you,
No, very welcome, man. Very welcome. I'll edit this up and throw this online. And it's been an honor and a pleasure. We're speaking. I'm Ken Ngwa, the director. Speaking with the great actor from South Africa.
Nature Boy. We can't wait for Nature Boy.
Thabo, Rametsi. Thank you, man. Thank you. Love always, man. Pan-Africanism.
Ciao. Peace and love.
Yes. All right, brother. I'll talk to you soon.